Hello and welcome, everyone, to the National World War I Museum and Memorial. I am Camille Kulig, Public Program Specialist. As always, thrilled to have you joining us, especially with this weather. Just speaks to the sturdiness and the commitment of this crowd here. This evening, we are joined by author of our book, When It Mattered Most, Kevin Ticen, and he'll be in conversation with Rob Hughes. So we'll talk for about 40, 45 minutes, and then afterwards, we'll have time to ask questions. So I just ask you, raise your hand. I will come to you with this mic, and because we are live streaming and filming for our YouTube channel, that you make sure the question is asked through the mic. Last piece, please make sure that the cell phones are silenced, and that is it. So please, without further ado, please help me in welcoming Rob Hughes and Kevin Ticen.
All right, is this on? Can anybody hear me? It is? Okay. How's everyone doing tonight? Thanks so much for being here. Yeah, like Camille said, I appreciate you braving the weather, and Kevin, appreciate you being here all the way from Seattle.
Yeah. We brought the Seattle's weather with us.
So. I appreciate you doing that very much.
Feel right at home.
Very, very much. Yeah. Well, it's all about Kevin tonight and his book. I'm with the local ABC CW affiliate. Again, my name is Rob Hughes, and worked a lot with the Mavericks and with the Museum and Memorial here, and appreciate this opportunity. I'm really looking forward to chatting with you, Kevin. I think you'll get a lot out of this, whether you're a hockey fan, sports fan, interested in history and World War One, or we're even going to talk a little bit about leadership and building a winning team, and you can get something out of that for your business or your team, and so it's really going to be, I think, a good discussion. So I will turn over the mic to you, Kevin. Why don't we just start by having you just kind of introduce yourself. Tell us a little bit about your background and kind of your life before you started this project here.
So I was a minor league baseball player and college baseball coach, which I know is a typical transitional career to writing. And then I was working at the Seattle Sports Commission for the last 6 years, and I still coach a 17, 18-year-old youth team, and so I'm still really involved in athletics on that side. And so at the Sports Commission, I was approached to help celebrate the centennial of the Metropolitans Championship. And as somebody that was born and raised in Seattle, I had absolutely no idea that this happened. And my joke is I got pulled into a random meeting that I had no idea why I was there and had my head down and heard someone say Seattle and Stanley Cup and popped my head up and I was in. So, and yeah.
And so you commit to this and you decide you're gonna write this book. Now how does it all start? What's the process of actually writing a book and how does it all begin?
Yeah, for me it started with research. And so other than knowing that they won, I had absolutely no idea what the story was. And I kind of laugh also that the day that I committed to actually going and researching it, I sent quite possibly the worst email ever written to the curator of the Hockey Hall of Fame, asking him 75 questions about, did people care about the Stanley Cup 100 years ago? What did professional hockey look like? Do we know anything about these guys? It was comical. And his response was, I don't know, it was 100 years ago. And I got up and walked to the Seattle Central Library and put the microfilm in and started scrolling through. And within 5 minutes, I knew that I was looking at a spectacular story and that I just had to figure out how to write it.
And it was a story that needed to be told. I mean, you say it's the of course, a forgotten story of America's first Stanley Cup champions and the war to end all wars. And you wanted to be that person to tell it.
Yeah, I mean, the truth is that I pitched multiple authors to write this. Part of my job at the Sports Commission is promoting Seattle as a sports destination, and I knew the story had to be written. I just read Boys in the Boat. It's a spectacular book. It is, really does a great job of describing competitive sports and Seattle and America and all those things, and just looking at this and feeling like it was a similar thread. And when I didn't get a response from any of the authors that I pitched, I think my wife got tired of me complaining about it and finally looked at me one day and said, you should just write it yourself. And luckily I'm dumb enough to actually think that I can do things sometimes and jumped in and here we are.
Not at all. Good for you. That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, I really appreciate you doing this. Now you are an athlete and a coach, Kevin, as you mentioned, and that really added a lot of depth in your perspective in writing this book. And we'll get into that a little bit later, but how did that kind of help you when you were researching and writing this book and your experience as an athlete and a coach?
So probably a year ago, I was watching a Netflix documentary on Ted Williams, and Bob Costas is interviewing him. And at one point, Bob Costas looked at him and said, "What does it feel like to hit a 90-mile-an-hour fastball?" And Ted Williams gets this, like, smile and describes it to him. And I was sitting there, and it was like the light bulb went off in my head. And it's, that's exactly why I could tell this story the way that I could, because I don't have to ask those questions. I know what it feels like to step into the locker room on the day that you're playing for a championship. I know what it feels like to get into that pennant stretch where every moment counts. And it was really a great journey for me to be able to get my thoughts in order and then breathe them into these guys.
And I know that of course you never met them, but you felt a deep personal connection to each of the players.
Absolutely. Yeah, and the thing that's sort of funny is I think one of my best attributes as a coach is I can read players. So I can look at them and I can see what motivates them and I can see what buttons to push. And so one of the first things I did was I assigned a player that I had coached to each one of these guys. And the funny thing is I was correct on all of the personality types with the exception of the goalie, and I had him down to two and I picked the wrong one. And you know, within a couple of weeks, I realized I'd picked the wrong one. And I used that to begin to understand these guys. And by the end, I knew everything about them. And it was interesting. I've gotten, you know, four or five emails from grandkids of the players. And it was really nice to hear that they felt like I really captured their spirit. So
that must have been rewarding for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, absolutely. It's probably the most rewarding aspect of this, really.
Yeah. All right, wonderful. Well, why don't we kind of start walking through the book then? Let's start at the very beginning, and I wish we had all night to go through the whole book, but let's start with the beginning, or even chapter one, if you will. Kind of paint a picture for us of the team, of the time, and then let's go from there.
So I think, you know, one of the things that I alluded to this earlier, that I had no idea what professional athletics were going to look like in the teens, right? There's no video, there's no radio, there's nothing to go back and look at. And in my head, it was this completely different entity, and, you know, I just saw them moving at half speed and gingerly going and fans not being that involved and anything like that. And immediately I could tell that the feeling for the players, the feelings for the community and the fans and everything was exactly the same. And so, you know, you have two rival leagues, and they have the NHA, which becomes the NHL in 1917. And the reality is they don't like one of the owners. And so they all go in a hotel room, disband the NHA, go into the next hotel room, sign a new contract without that guy in it and call it the NHL. And that's how the league's formed. And the PCHA is the West Coast League. And so the Patricks, if you've seen Miracle, right, their grandson, Craig Patrick, is the assistant coach. And, you know, they are gods in a hockey world. And, you know, their names are all over the Stanley Cup. And so the Patricks move out west because their dad buys a swath of land in Nelson, B.C. They're all from Montreal. They both won the Cup, or Lester's won the Cup, and Frank is one of the top amateur players, and they make a ton of money in the West, and their dad at like 30 years old says, "Well, do whatever you want with the money now," and they form a professional hockey league. And so they have outstanding relationships with all the best players. They have money, and the climate out west is significantly better than Northeast Canada. And so they're able to poach all these great players and bring them out. And that starts a huge player war between the two leagues, and it simmers, and then it ends with the agreement that the PCHA and the NHA will play for the Stanley Cup. And so previously it was only the winner of the NHA that would, it was a Challenge Cup, and then the winner of the NHA got it. This player war is finally in check and everything's good. And then the Toronto owner flares up again. And so the Patricks go and they take five of the best players off of Toronto's 1914 Stanley Cup champion team and bring them out and put them on Seattle's team. And so immediately Seattle's a contender in their expansion year. It's a pretty fascinating story.
Exciting. And it gives the backdrop of Seattle in 1917, which you mentioned to this day, a huge sports town. I mean, the community really embraced this, right? Talk a little bit just about Seattle then.
Yeah, it was interesting. So even like the day that we did the book launch, I was doing a similar talk with one of our most prominent journalists, and he's born and raised in Seattle, and he made the joke about Seattle being an outpost and a podunk town, and And the reality is we all think of Seattle like that 100 years ago, and it wasn't. It was this city that was flourishing and that wanted to be taken seriously, and obviously it was very far away from the rest of the country. But Bill Boeing is, you know, the first Boeing flight happens in that first season. Nordstrom is taking off. UPS is flourishing in Seattle, and you have all these great businesses and this downtown core. So the Smith Tower is the tallest building west of the Mississippi. It had just been finished, and it got beat by a tower in Kansas City a few years later. And so you had this city that was really trying to step out from its, past, pioneer past, so to speak, of just being a logging town. And it was just a great confluence of events that happened.
Perfect. Okay, so we kind of get an understanding of the history then and the league and how it was formed. Now let's go into the Seattle Metropolitans. Now, yeah. Tell us about the early days of the team, the coaches, the players, and then let's talk about each one too if we can.
Yeah, so the team is formed for the 2015-16 season. That's the expansion year. The arena was downtown. If you've ever been to Seattle, it was on 5th and University, so it's across the street from the Fairmont Hotel, which is like right smack dab in the middle of downtown. Pete Muldoon is the head coach, and he is from St. Mary's, Ontario, and his real name is Linton Tracy. And he drops out of college. He's a law student and moves to Seattle to pursue a boxing career. And his parents do not approve of the boxing career. And so they ask him to change his name. And so he chooses Pete Muldoon. Yeah, they don't want a professional athlete in the family. And Muldoon is just fascinating character, really. I mean, he's an ice dancer. He's a professional boxer. He is a phenomenal hockey player. He's a phenomenal baseball player, lacrosse player, just a great athlete. And he's Pete Carroll 100 years before Pete Carroll is Pete Carroll. And he just really outgoing personality, really warm and engaging guy. And the funny thing is, so he goes and he becomes the very first head coach for the Chicago Blackhawks and doesn't like it in Chicago and comes back to Seattle after the first year and then dies from a heart attack in 1929. So he's 41 years old. He's a 3-year-old and a 2-year-old. And on his death, the headline in the Seattle Times is above the sports header, says Pete Muldoon dies. And then in the Post-Intelligencer, which was the other primary paper, it's front page, above the fold, center column, massive story. So,
yeah, I was going to USC when Pete Carroll was there, and just the energy and the electricity he brought to mm-hmm. the school was incredible. And I'm sure Pete Muldoon, of course, did that for the Metropolitans, or the Mets is the short. Yeah. So let's talk about him real quick, how he built this winning team. How did he get started? How did he build the foundation for them to win the Stanley Cup?
Yeah, so he came in and, you know, obviously had this foundation of having multiple players come from a team that had already won the Cup, and one's the goalie, one is a star center, one is a star defensive player. So he has the nucleus for a great team. And the thing that's interesting is four of the other players that are on the team are all guys that have been cut from other teams. And so he basically pulls, you know, guys off the scrap heap and coaches them up and really gets them going in the same direction. And, you know, one interesting thing about hockey in the teens is it is an unbelievably violent sport. You know, there's instances of guys taking full swings with their sticks and knocking people off their skates, and, you know, people getting teeth knocked in on a routine basis. And, you know, the penalty minutes are off the charts. And when the Seattle season starts the first year, the Metropolitans are right in the middle of the whole thing. And you can tell immediately that he's frustrated, and he wants them to just to compete and to play hard and to play skillful. And there's multiple comments in the newspapers over the first month about, you know, we need to get this aggression under control. And by the end of the season, they're one of the least penalized teams. The first half of the year, they have the worst offense and the worst defense, which is not typically a strong indicator of success. And by the end of the season, they have the second best offense and the second best defense. And then over the course of his tenure, you know, so the Metropolitans were the most successful franchise in the Pacific Coast Hockey Association while they were there in their 9 years. And they consistently had, you know, the first or second best offense and the first or second best defense. And so it's a really well-rounded special team.
Real quick, Kevin, since we're talking about Pete Muldoon, what takeaways can we all get from him and his success and his leadership? if you will.
Yeah, I mean, I think the thing that he did so well was he took the strengths of each guy and he put them in position to maximize those strengths. And so, you know, he took guys that were, you know, not only cut off of other teams, but they were forwards and you know, or centers, and he made them defensive players. And he was just really good at moving guys around. And the other thing, you could really get a sense for his ability to teach, you know. And so they were struggling early in the year with their goal stopping, and you know, he would bring his younger players in and have them shoot at the goalie and just practice. And so the young guys are getting practice on their scoring, and the goalie's getting practice on preventing it. So just really well organized and intelligent guy.
Fascinating. And let's talk about the players on the team. Let's go through them one by one. Is there, let's see, how about we start with Frank Voisin? Tell me about him.
So Frank Voisin to me is Joe Montana. You know, he's the guy that made the whole thing happen. He's the first player for the Metropolitans to go into the Hockey Hall of Fame, and I think he's the third Western player to go in. He's not the best scorer. He's not the best defender. He's not the best in anything, but he's the guy. He makes it all happen. He's the guy that, you know, makes the plays when the stress is highest, and, you know, in any critical situation, you can see the puck in his hands all the time. So, special player.
Right. What about Bernie Morris?
Bernie Morris was a fascinating character. You know, I'm writing a document right now to ask the Hall of Fame committee to reevaluate his career. So he's, in a lot of people's opinion, the best player not yet inducted in the Hall of Fame. It's obviously an uphill battle to get somebody inducted 100 years later. When we're doing research on him at a librarian at the University of Washington, uncover a court document from 1909 that basically told us that his mom had died when he was 3 and his dad had died when he's 9 years old, and he was orphaned, and it was a tragic life. I mean, it was every bad thing that could happen to a human being happened to him. I'm probably going to steal part of the later discussion, but it's such a good story. So, you know, he gets suspended in the course of the player wars. He's the only player ever suspended. And then the next year, he finally reports and gets his first chance to play Major League Hockey, and is injured the whole year and gets cut, and then comes out the first year with the Metropolitans and leads the league in goals. The second year, he sets the all-time points record in the league. The third year, the war is happening, and so it's the year's a bit of a train wreck. And then the day that the 1919 playoffs begin, he doesn't show up for the game, and he's been arrested for draft evasion. And he's a Canadian citizen. He's not very sophisticated, doesn't, you know, take care of his details very well, and he didn't file his paperwork correctly, and and lost a year of his life. And so this really sensational front page newspaper trial plays out over the course of the playoffs and the Stanley Cup final that year, and the series ends in a tie. Spanish flu outbreak hits Seattle, and Bernie Morris is sitting in prison in Fort Lewis the entire time and is sentenced to 2 years hard labor at Alcatraz. So he ends up getting the sentence commuted. He granted an honorable discharge and sent to the 1920 final. And, you know, I don't think he really ever recovered from that either. And he's a guy that late in life had a falling out with everybody and died alone and in a military hospital in Bremerton, Washington. It's the only death not reported in the newspapers. And, you know, he's just a guy that was very, very gifted on the ice and had a really tragic life off it.
Of course, we plan to work in World War One's impact on the team, which we did there. Yeah. And tell us about the rest of the players and just kind of the key takeaways and researching them. You really got to know them in a way.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, you know, Jack Walker and Hap Holmes are the other two Hall of Famers. So Hap Holmes was the goalie, and Jack Walker played a position called Rover. And so it's a hybrid between a defenseman and a forward now. And he invented a technique called the hook check, and he's just the stopper. He could go and take anyone's best player and end their night. He was a phenomenal player. Hap Holmes was the guy that I got his personality incorrect. I couldn't tell if he was a really fiery guy or if he was a very passive, quiet guy, and he was the passive, quiet guy. And he was an interesting character, and there were some really funny anecdotes that came out through the newspapers of his personality. He was that guy that didn't say much, but when he did, it was on point. And, you know, he could really lighten the locker room, or he could really get guys going in the right direction. Bobby Rowe's a defenseman, and he's the brains behind, a lot of it. And he's Frank Voisin's the captain, and Bobby Rowe's the second captain for sure. And Bobby Rowe goes down to Portland and coaches their minor league team for 20 years after his career ends, and so he stays in the Northwest. And it was a phenomenal team. Jim Riley is the youngest player on the team. He's a forward that comes in, and the neat thing about him is when he gets when the Pacific Coast Hockey Association blows up, he goes and plays for Pete Muldoon with the Chicago Blackhawks. He also is a professional baseball player and plays for the St. Louis Browns, I believe. So he's the only player to play Major League Baseball and in the NHL.
Wow.
Yeah, good athlete. And he's a scratch golfer later in life.
Okay.
So, yeah.
All right, so why don't we work in the World War One angle here, being at the World War One Museum and Memorial. We already talked about it a little bit. Some of the players ended up serving for a time as well. Tell me about kind of the war's impact on the team and their success.
It really had a dramatic impact on the league, on professional hockey, right? So Canada's already in the war. And it's interesting, the Victoria team ends up losing their arena. The Canadian military commandeers it as a weapons depot. In the NHA and the Eastern League, they don't have enough players to field four teams. And so with players leaving and going to the front, and so they form a military team. And so they call it the 228th Battalion team. And basically, the players are sent back to Toronto for basic training, and they have them play on this team while they're there. And that's the 1917 season. Frank Voisin serves. He doesn't actually go overseas. He's used as a public affairs person. He's fairly famous at that point. Jim Riley does go overseas. He's the only one that does. Jack Walker and Eddie Carpenter both serve, but don't go overseas. And there are a lot of players that do. You know, there's two or three guys off of each team that go and fight in the 1917 season or 1918 season. And the war had a dramatic effect. One of the most fascinating anecdotes for me was there was a letter that Pete Muldoon got from the front from one of his friends, and it was printed in its entirety in all of the Seattle newspapers and all of the British Columbia newspapers and all of the Oregon newspapers. And it was very dramatic, really detailed on what was happening at the front. And it was interesting. You could tell that the war consumed their lives. You know, it was incredible. Yeah.
Now tell you write with an incredible attention to detail, I noticed, in the book. I mean, of course, you are obviously our writer, but if you haven't had a chance to read the book yet, I'd highly recommend it, because you feel, as we've already said, like you're there with them. You feel like you know them personally. How do you do that, and what do you want people to get out of the book when they read it with that style you have?
Yeah, I mean, that was my primary goal, was I wanted the reader to experience hockey or professional sports or life in the teens. I wanted you to understand what it felt like to watch the game and the passion that was involved and the athleticism that was involved on the ice, and then the drama that played out off the ice, not to spoil a lot of the book, the very first day of research, right, I'm scrolling through the March of 1917 Seattle Post Intelligencer or microfilms, and I get to 2 days before game one of the Stanley Cup final, and the headline's this big, and it says Tsar abdicates, right? And it was shocking to see that, 2 days before, and just thinking about, what the conversations were like around the dinner table and what the conversations in the locker room were like. And then as I went back, over the course of the season, it got better, right? And as we were talking about, previously, so January 31st is the day that the pennant stretch basically begins. All three teams or all the teams in the league play that day. And they all wake up the next morning, and it's the first mention in any of the newspapers about, someone winning a championship. And it's also the day that the Zimmerman telegram is sent, right? And so that was another moment where, as I was doing research, I couldn't believe that these things had been dropped on top of each other. And it was an easy, once I figured out the writing component of it, of the storytelling, it was a very easy story to tell. And then the details were just there. It was easy to drop them in.
And what did winning the championship do for Seattle at that time?
A lot. It was, so Royal Brougham, if you've ever been to Seattle, the street between Safeco Field and Century or T-Mobile, whatever it's called these days, the two stadiums, is called Royal Brougham Way. And for most people in Seattle, they think that it's just a street. And so Royal Brougham was the longtime sports editor of the Post Intelligencer newspaper. And he served from the teens until the 70s, and he actually died of a heart attack in the Kingdom watching a Seahawks game. And he's the Metropolitans official scorer. We laugh, he covered the Sonics, the Seahawks, the Mariners, and the Metropolitans. And the day that game one of the Stanley Cup final begins, the lead line in his article is, "Seattle's ready to shake the dust off of small town sports." You know, and it was the city that really wanted to be something, you know, really wanted to look like New York or Chicago or, you know, San Francisco. And 100 years later, it's still true. You know, it hasn't changed at all. But it was that first instance for Seattle to stick its chest out and to feel success at something. So it was great impact.
We mentioned a little bit earlier that the descendants, the family members of the players, mm-hmm. have contacted you, and that's the most rewarding mm-hmm. part. Walk us through that. What was that like? How did that all come to be?
So the 89-year-old daughter, she's about to turn 90, Frank Voisten, is still alive and still lives in the Seattle area. And so as I'm a little bit into research and understanding that there's truly a story, I get connected to her and sat down and interviewed her. And it was the pride like in her eyes when I was talking to her about her dad's story, and the excitement to hear that someone was going to tell it. And, you know, part of the reason that these guys also fell off the face of the earth is they're so humble. They just competed and they played, and when they were done, they were done. They weren't going around telling everyone that they had won this thing. And she said he never talked about it. She said the only time he ever heard stories of it were when his teammates would come over on Sundays, or some of the players that he'd coached, and all of the families. That was a theme that ran through all of the grandkids, is they didn't really know any of the story. And so it was very rewarding for them, or for me, to hear from them after they read the story. So I talked to Pete Muldoon's grandkids, and obviously their dad died when, you know, I think their dad was 2 when he died, and so barely knew anything other than what her grandmother had told her, and Roy Rickey's grandkids, and the Foystons, and yeah, a lot of them. So,
okay. Got an excerpt I'd like to read for you guys. Is that all right? This is from chapter 8. We're talking about championship teams, and this is one of my favorite parts of the book. It says, you write, Gavin, "Championship teams typically have a great player to make the plays when it matters most. Players that lessen the pressure on their teammates, thereby allowing the team to perform its best. Soon, a flat spot becomes a winning streak. Great players don't do anything extra. They don't force the action. They simply trust they will succeed and just play. The game remains slow to them, which allows their best performance. They anticipate plays rather than react to them, seeing the holes to exploit and opportunities to score rather than frantically committing to a bad course of action." That's awesome. That's incredible insight. Tell us a little bit about how that applied to the team.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, that's just coaching.
I had never been a pro coach or player.
You just see it a lot. I mean, I experienced it as a player, you know, and it's funny, you hear, like, I'll listen to broadcasts of games, and the platitudes that get dropped from the commentators make me laugh, you know, most of the time. And, you know, the adage avail at it, and realize that you made a moment bigger than you needed to make it. And you reach a point where you say, you know what, like, we may win, we may lose, but I'm going to commit to a course of action. I'm going to be okay with the outcome. And yeah, it was fun for me to weave those things in. And, you know, 100% I was conscious of this was their story and not mine. And so not wanting to impose my footprint on it, but the story lent itself very well. Pete Muldoon, you know, I would read quotes from him and interviews from him, and it would make me laugh that 100 years before he was thinking the same thoughts that I think in every game. And Frank Foyston, same way, you know, just the way that he would communicate with the media was very similar to how I played the game. He was certainly more talented than I was. And it was fun for me to really be able to explain what they were doing and why they were doing it in hopefully an authentic way.
Absolutely. And then also in the same chapter, winning championships wasn't always about your best versus their best. It's often finding a way to win with the best you have on that particular day against their best. And so as we know, good teams find a way to win, even if it's not pretty. Can you talk about that and how it applied to the Metropolitans?
I mean, I think that, you know, when you're on a championship, when you're not on a championship team and you see a championship team, that you look and think that they get every break and that everything goes their way, and you know, it's, they don't, you know, face adversity. And when you're on the inside of a championship team, it feels like a disaster every day, you know. And I was on two teams that won the Pac-10 championship when I was in college, and we were the first Northern teams to ever win the championship, right? We're playing against USC and UCLA and ASU and all these, just, you know, the powerhouses of college baseball. And, you know, going through that year, especially the second year, we felt like we were losers every day. You know, every day we would show up and something dumb would happen, or we would make a mistake. And then, you know, come late May, you look up, you're like, oh, you know what, we're still in first place. You know, like, this thing, this championship thing is not about playing perfectly all the time. It's about, you know, competing and grinding through adversity and, you know, trial and error and, you know, at the end of the day, playing hard, right? And if you're talented enough, you'll succeed. And if you're not, you need to get better. And, you know, this team battled a lot of adversity. One of my favorite scenes or games is Bernie Morris gets critically injured late in the season. And at this point, I'm pretty connected to these guys and to this team. And I read this in the newspaper, and I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe, you know, no. Yeah. And, you know, and he comes back 3 days later and scores three goals, you know. And Jack Walker on multiple occasions is so injured that he can barely walk, you know, and he goes out and competes. And there's seen games where Jack Walker gets knocked out cold and is back in the game a minute and a half later. They're wiping the pool of blood off the ice, you know, and
different time.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I mean, there were 20 times this team could have folded, you know, and to me, that was the best part of the story. I'm laughed. It's Hoosiers, right? It's Hoosiers put on ice. Dropped on you know, World War One.
And so really, I know we've talked about winning teams, but what about the culture of the team? You talked about how some of these guys had gotten cut, and Pete Muldoon was able to make them great. Yeah. Tell me a little bit more about the culture of the team.
I think that, you know, at the end of the day, great coaches just hold players to a higher standard, right? I think that you look at players and you see what they're capable of, and you aren't going to let them settle for not being, you know, their greatest version. And, you know, he certainly did that, right? And he wouldn't let them, you know, play a less disciplined style. He wouldn't let them play a less team-oriented style. You know, and the Eastern League is unbelievably, you know, the most talented player is going to have the most successful team. It's just a real individual sport. And the Western League was extremely team oriented, and that was one of the reasons the Metropolitan had so much success in the final. Is, you know, they could come at the Canadians from five different angles, and the Canadians had two answers, and they put Jack Walker on him and shut it down, you know. And Muldoon was a phenomenal coach, you know, phenomenal coach.
And you kind of liken him to Pete Carroll, we talked about. What about for the team itself, the Mets? Is there a kind of a modern day team you'd liken them to?
That's a great question. You know, and the funny thing is, I've thought about this, and I feel like I had an answer at one point. I mean, I would say that they were like the mid '90s Bulls.
Yeah.
You know, just you have the most talented player, Michael Jordan, and the 10th player is better than every other team's second best player or best player. You know, and that was the thing that the Metropolitans could do, is you couldn't stop the offense because there was three guys that were better than the other team's best forward. And I shouldn't say that, because the Vancouver Millionaires, their entire team in 1917 is in the Hockey Hall of Fame. So they were unbelievably talented. You know, and that just shows the grittiness that the Metropolitans had, that they could hold them off. You know, but yeah, I mean, the Metropolitans could win every style of game. They could win from every angle, and it was a defensive-oriented team that scored a lot. So,
and after the the championship. Kind of walk us through the team and kind of the evolution of the team and the league and what happens after that.
Yeah. So immediately after the championship, the U.S. declares war on Germany 6 days later, and that put a huge damper on any celebration. And the next season is like I said, scattered. You know, players have to go to different teams. Players go in fights, and then everyone comes back for the 1919 season and plays on the original teams. The Metropolitans stay until the 1923-24 season, and then in only a Seattle-esque story, they get kicked out of their arena with a year left on the lease, and they're disbanded. Muldoon goes to Chicago, and he coaches the Blackhawks. Frank Foyston and Hap Holmes and I believe Jack Walker go to Detroit. So they go to Victoria for 2 years, and then Victoria moves to Detroit and becomes the Red Wings, and they play on that team. And then the Portland team goes to Chicago and becomes the Blackhawks. And then two of the players go and play on the expansion Boston Bruins team. So almost all of them go and play on some pretty famous, well-known NHL teams. So.
And after kind of each of their retirement, if you will, from the sport, what do they do then kind of later in life?
Almost all of them come back to Seattle. And Frank Foyston coaches the minor league team in Seattle after Pete Muldoon dies. And he's also a turkey farmer with Bernie Morris. So they have adjoining turkey farms. They have a massive falling out over chicken feed or turkey feed, I guess, at some point in the 1940s. And that's when Bernie is ostracized from the community. Jack Walker works at the Rainier Brewery. So again, if you're from Seattle, that's a pretty cool job. I'm sure it'd be like if you're from St. Louis working at the Bud plant. Yeah. And, you know, they all stay in hockey. You know, like I said, Bobby Rowe goes to Portland and coaches, and they're all referees and coaches, and three of them go in the Hall of Fame, and they all remain unbelievably close friends until their deaths. And so they all, the first one dies, Hap Holmes dies in the early 50s, and then the rest of them are in the 60s, and I think Jim Riley is the early 70s. And they're all huge headlines in the Seattle papers when they die, and then the team's talked about in the mid-70s when Royal Brougham's beginning to get sick. He writes a remembrance series and writes a really dramatic article about the Metropolitans. And then they're talked about once on the 75th anniversary, and then all the work we did on the 100th anniversary. But other than that, they'd by the 60s had completely fallen off the map.
But thanks to you and your work there, you know, you're getting it back in the history books, if you will.
And there's a lot of people in Seattle that have had a hand in this. And there's a guy that actually went out. He's from Korea and moved to America when he was 4 or 5 years old. And someone handed him a book about the Seattle Metropolitans, a children's book, winning the Stanley Cup. And he says that that's how he learned English. And played hockey through high school and club hockey in college, and he actually bought the Metropolitans trademark 10 years ago and has been trying to you know, revitalize it. And he's the guy that approached me and asked me to help. And so there's a lot of people in the community that have really stepped up and helped bring these guys back to life. And it's funny, we actually got criticized for using the word forgotten on Twitter, you know, a couple of months after the book came out, and like, they're not forgotten, we all know this. And the joke is like, nobody knew it before the 100 year anniversary, now everybody does. And I think, you know, we're all hoping that as the new NHL team comes, that it'll become a national story. You know, I mean, these are guys that that achieved something incredible. And you know, the fact that it's the first American team to win the Stanley Cup is very neat, but just the way in which they won their championship is you know, fascinating. And really the 1919, the co-championship is pretty spectacular as well. So, you know, 15 years later when there's TV and there's radio, these guys are still famous, right? It just was that small, you know, sliver of time where, you know, they're in the Pacific Northwest and, you know, playing a sport that you could only write about. And they were lost.
The co-championship was when I think because there was the
influence
of, and so that's almost kind of an impact, if you will, of the war and the times.
Yeah,
I'm not sure if we touched on that real quick. Could you?
I did a little bit with Bernie Morris, but you know, it's 1919. All the teams are back and intact, and you know the day that so game five is played, or game four is at that time considered the greatest hockey game ever played. So it's a double overtime game, ends in a 0-0 tie. And players start collapsing on the ice at the end of the game, and nobody knows what's going on. They just think that they're exhausted, and then they come back and they have to replay by those rules. Metropolitans are up 4-1 going into the third period. They never lose late. This is like the only game that they lose late. And the Canadians score 3 late goals to tie it, goes into overtime, another double overtime, and the Canadians end up winning because 2 Metropolitans players are injured, and then a third collapses on the ice. And keep in mind that, you know, the best scorer for the Metropolitans is in prison and not playing. And the Canadians, you know, win the game. The Metropolitans have outscored them by more than 10 goals in the series. And then they wake up the next morning, and 5 of the Canadians players have to be hospitalized, and 3 of the Metropolitans. And the Canadians offer to forfeit. And, you know, they can't play, they can't put a team on the ice, and the Metropolitans won't accept it because they didn't win it, you know, fair and square. And then the Canadians want to bring in minor league players to play, and the Metropolitans won't let them do that. And the health department comes in and shuts the series down.
So we know nowadays you have a lot of star athletes who obviously do pretty well, but mm-hmm. we know for a long time athletes didn't make much money. A lot of them had jobs in the offseason, right? Yeah. So really they played, I would imagine, for love of the game as well, right? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I mean, they're well paid. They make more than the average person, but certainly not life-changing money. If you've ever been to Seattle, so Frank Foyson worked in the Pike Place Market. His wife, his future wife, her family owned the butcher shop there, and so he worked in the butcher shop. Pete Muldoon, the head coach, owned all the concession stands at the zoo in Seattle and at one of the sort of bigger parks, and he employed a lot of the players. And, you know, a lot of them are farmers, and so they would go back to their farms, and then a lot of them did sporting goods stores and things like that. And so, you know, it was interesting. One of the Canadians players is the highest paid athlete of, you know, that year, and Ty Cobb made more money than he did in a season, but baseball played 144 games then, and hockey played 24, and he made $1,500 for the year, so not a lot of money. Yeah.
So it's kind of looking back on all this, Kevin, we already talked about how it's rewarding to hear from the mm-hmm. descendants, but what are you really most proud of with all the work and the effort that went into this and telling this story?
You know, that's a good question. I don't think that I've ever thought about that part of it. You know, and I certainly didn't do it for any of those reasons. I think at the end of the day, I felt like that I would be upset if people forgot about a championship that I was a part of. And as much as anything, just, you know, feeling a need to advocate for these guys that, again, accomplished something special. And so, you know, I don't think I necessarily feel a sense of pride, maybe in actually being able to figure out how to write the book. And in the process, I realized something that I'm just as passionate about as I am with baseball. I love to write. It's something that has been a thread throughout everything I've ever done without realizing it. You know, and so, yeah, I feel very good that this story is getting out and that people are enjoying the story, and that, you know, these incredible, you know, men and this time period are getting some justice. And obviously with the 100-year anniversary of the armistice signed, there's been a lot of stories that have come out about the war too. And, you know, it's not to go off on a massive tangent, but for me, like, my great-grandfather was a soldier in World War I, you know, and he was in his late 80s when I knew him, and, you know, was very slow walking and very slow talking. And like I said, it always seemed like such a different time to me. And you know, my grandfather fought in World War II, and he was so vibrant. And, you know, for whatever weird bias that I had, I just always saw this as a completely different time period that I couldn't relate to. And I think that that's probably what I'm most proud of, is being able to, in my own little weird way, breathe some humanity back into this time period, and hopefully get people that wouldn't otherwise be interested in the topic to understand, you know, what a massive impact the war had on society, and what, you know, a massive, just, it was a horrible event that, you know, we need to learn about and understand. And so I certainly learned a lot about it and loved it, and have a completely different, like I've said this probably 3 times today, you know, thought in my head of what sports looked like in the teens and what life did. So
Well, you do such a great job of articulating that because, yeah, as you've said, we think black and white. We think, you know, sometimes our grandparents, we know them in their later years, but you really bring these guys to life in their prime when they're winning the championship, the Stanley Cup.
Yeah, and another great way for me to explain it is the scene in They Shall Not Grow Old when the tank comes out of the trench and turns to color. Like, that's what this whole process was like for me. Where it just, you know, was this choppy black and white footage that I couldn't relate to, and then became a vivid color where I could see these people walking down the streets, and I could see them, you know, over in the trenches, and I could see them on the ice, and it was a very vivid picture in my head, and it was well worth it, certainly.
And you reminded me of talking about the trenches, the fundraiser that was held where the trenches were simulated. Could you kind of explain what I'm talking about there?
Yeah, so an interesting anecdote, the librarian at the University of Washington that found the Bernie Morris document also had put this document together that she sent me. And in December of 1917, so after the Mets had won the championship, they turned the ice arena into a bazaar, and it was a fundraiser for the war effort. And they actually created the trenches so that people could come in and experience it. And I think their goal was to raise $100,000. And the day that it opened, they had already achieved half of it. They did it immediately. But it was interesting to me that they used the arena to do that, and they pushed the season back.
Awesome. Yeah. So Kevin, since we have our audience here, just maybe do you want to kind of give them a message as far as why they should read the book or have their friends or family read it? Just kind of speak to them real quick.
Yeah, I think even if you're not a hockey fan, I think that you'll enjoy the sports side of it. And if you are a hockey fan, I think that it'll – it's just another story, another phenomenal story to sit with all the other great hockey stories that are out there. It's a very fascinating time period and great sporting event and just a great confluence of events that came together. So, and I hope you enjoy it. You know, I hope you can connect to the characters and the players as much as I did.
We got time. Anything else you want to kind of add before we take some questions maybe from the audience or? You did a great job, Kevin. I appreciate your time,
and
it's a fascinating book. I really appreciate you writing
thank
it
you.
Very much.
Yeah.
Camille, do we want to
We're open to some questions, so just raise your hand, and I will come to you. We'll start here, and I'll make my way over on that side.
So the Stanley Cup name, how is it that the NHL got to take the name with them? Was it because the NHA dissolved because of the war? How did the Stanley Cup name...
So the that's a great question. The Stanley Cup predates all of that. So the Stanley Cup was a challenge cup that was made for amateur teams in the first year is 1893. And for the first 10 to 12 years, it's all amateur teams, and they have to challenge each other for it. And it's two-game series and aggregate goals. Basically, and then around 1910, the NHA gets its hands on it, and other teams can still challenge them for it. And then 1914 is the first year that the PCHA and the NHA play for it. And then it doesn't completely go into the NHL's hands until 1927. So that's the first year that the NHL owns it. And the thing that's interesting to me is if you look at the NHL records, they only go to 1917. You know, and it's just, they just picked the date and went with it, you know, and the reality is there is nothing different. The team names didn't change, the players didn't change, the coaches didn't change. They didn't like one owner, and it was their only way. He was threatening lawsuits, and he was doing all these things, and the owners are obviously very intelligent, you know, and some of them are lawyers, and so they figure out if they dissolve the league, and then write a new charter that's verbatim what the NHA charter is, that's their way to get him out of the league. So, yeah.
First off, I want to say thanks for coming. I've been a statistician for the Kansas City Mavericks for 10 years now, and my degree was actually history. So this is like the best date night ever for me.
Very cool.
So I've been kind of climbing through the branches of my husband's family history, and his great-grandfather actually played in the NHL for just one game, but he played primarily in the NHL for the St. Paul Saints and just some other leagues. So my question for you is, what resources can I go to kind of learn more? I found some newspaper articles through Ancestry, but I didn't know if you'd recommend like JSTOR or EBSCOhost or just like hitting up the local library is my question for you.
I would start at the library. They're very, very good at researching and pointing people in the right direction. I use Ancestry a lot. I use newspaper a lot. The Library of Congress has a great database that you can go in and you can pull a lot of the old newspapers out. Newspapers.com, you have to pay for the service, but they have a lot of great newspapers. And then if you can get to the cities where that took place, there's a lot more microfilm and things like that. So I would highly recommend it. It'll be a fun journey for you. I'll also apologize because I realized that I had my back to you guys the entire time. So you got to hear the voice and not look at the mug. So, but I would encourage you. I think it'll be a fun journey. And there's a lot more information than you think that'll be out there.
Our next question.
Is there any sentiment toward naming the new NHL team the Metropolitans? And if there isn't, why not?
Yes, there is. We've all been told that the NHL is heavily frowning upon using that name, just dealing with any sort of trademark stuff with the New York Mets, and then there's a Metropolitan Division in the NHL, and they don't want to deal with that. And my standard line to that is that I don't really care about the team name. You know, if the NBA ever comes back to Seattle and it's not the Sonics, there will be massive riots in the streets. But with this, you know, it was 100 years ago. The team name, so the University of Washington, the original campus is downtown, and that's the largest part of the endowment that the university has. And this, the arena sat on the university's land. And so the land management company, it was called the Metropolitan Building Tract, and the land is called the Metropolitan Tract. And so that's where the team name came from. The Metropolitan Building Company built the arena at a massive discount. So it was the first naming rights, deal done. And so, once I learned that too, I didn't really care about the team name. I do think that they should raise the banners. You know, there was an article in one of the Seattle papers, like, leave the banners, in the storage shed. And my response is like, this isn't a franchise trying to, capture someone else's past glory. It's championships or cities, and more than that, they're still grandkids. Like we talked about, there are, living in the area and they're going to walk in and they should see those banners hanging there and they should be able to tell their friends that their, grandparents and great grandparents won these things. And, and so it's been fun. It's been a huge point of pride in Seattle again. And mostly just because of the way that the team played.
Hi, I grew up in the 50s in New York, and my dad was an unbelievable hockey fan.
Lester
His family
Patrick.
Was from Quebec, and he used to take me to watch the Rangers all the time. And it seems to me at that time there was only six teams. Is that true back in the 50s? What happened between your time, you're talking seven, up to like the mid-50s, that they only ended up with six teams at that time?
So the truth is, I'm a baseball person, so if you want to know real stuff, you have to ask me baseball questions. I can actually answer that question. So there's when the Metropolitans are playing, there's eight teams. So there's four in the West and four in the East. And then when the West Coast League goes under, two teams go to the East, and there's six teams. And it's the Detroit, Chicago, Boston, two Montreal teams, and Toronto. And I think Ottawa goes away for a year. And then there's some flux for 4 or 5 years. And then it settles in with the original six, which are Boston, Detroit, Chicago, New York, and Montreal, and Toronto. Yeah, and it stays there for a long time, and then it expands. But those are, yeah, I mean, it's interesting that two of the original six are Northwest teams, and the Rangers were the last expansion team. Yeah. Yeah, and Lester Patrick, his family is all still in the Northwest, and one of the first events, we had the Stanley Cup in Seattle on the 100-year, or to mark the 100-year anniversary, and I was standing there with the curator of the Hall of Fame. That's how I knew him well enough to send the worst email ever written. And we're all standing there, and we can hear these people talking, and he kind of like starts listening, and he's like, no, these people are more than just the casual person, and it was his grandkids. So, Yeah.
This will be our last question. Okay.
Do you have any parallels between Boys in the Boat and the Seattle hockey team you're talking about?
Yeah, there's a lot of parallels in the story, certainly. And, you know, the truth is he was one of the guys that I pitched to write the story. And I laugh, like I'd have much rather read his book than mine. I think he's a phenomenal writer. We had a really great exchange when I was finished writing, and he congratulated me on getting it done. And the stories were great, and it needed to be told. And I laugh, like if somebody would ask me today to write a story, I would know. You know, if it's not one that I'm super passionate about, I can't jump in and do it. And so I completely understand. But yeah, it's a wonderfully written book. It's a wonderfully written story. And it's amusing to me that, you know, two similar stories came out of the same small town. You know, and that was one of the things that I said to him, too, is, you know, I almost feel like if this thing does anything, that it's going to look like I was, you know, jumping on your coattails. And like the reality is I just wrote the story that was there, and his response was, you absolutely wrote the story that was there, you know, don't worry about it. And so, and if you haven't read Boys in the Boat, you should do it.
I lied. We'll do one more question.
We love talking, so we have no
problem.
You mentioned that the U.S. went into World War One 6 days after the Cup. I was wondering, between the Canadian aspect of a U.S. team winning the Cup and the U.S. view of a U.S. team winning the Cup, was there animosity, or how did Canada view it, and how did the U.S. view, I mean, did the U.S. care about hockey at the time? And obviously Canada cared about hockey at the mm-hmm. time, and how did they go over in the two countries?
That is a phenomenal question. Yeah, great question. Glad that we snuck that one in. Although I didn't understand, did the U.S. care about the Stanley Cup? Yes, very, very, very much. It was very important. Canada, there was no animosity. In 2 years prior, the Portland team actually plays for the Stanley Cup in 1916 and loses. And so they're the first American team to play for the Cup. And there was a huge debate between the Stanley Cup trustees on if they were going to let an American team win it. And it came back and it said, basically, this is the world's championship for hockey. World's championship means, you know, wherever they come from. And there was a little bit of a thread that said, no, like the actual charter for the Cup says Canadian, you know, amateur championship. But to answer your question, no, there was no animosity. The Canadians were not pleased. The Montreal Canadiens were not pleased that they lost the Cup, obviously. You know, again, there's some fun anecdotes that are in the book that I won't steal or won't ruin for you, that I want to ruin right now, but I'll keep my mouth shut, that show you how much the Canadians were upset and didn't think that there was any way that American team was going to beat them. And it was heavily covered. It got picked up nationally. So like the New York Times picked it up, and you know, the Boston newspapers and the St. Louis newspapers and the Kansas City newspapers, and it was picked up nationally when the Metropolitans won.
Can I sneak in one more real quick? Sorry, I forgot to ask Kevin the title, when it mattered most, where that came from.
That's another great question. So it's not the title that I chose, and it's actually the third title that we had, and I think that's fairly normal in the process. And it's one of the last, it ends the second to the last sentence in the book, and I was advocating for the word that ends the last sentence, and I kept advocating and kept advocating and kept advocating, and the publisher said, that's not the right word, you can't use that word. The word's immortality, right? He's like, they're not immortal, and I was like, no, but they are. We're writing about them 100 years later, like we still care. And I made one last ditch effort for immortality, mostly because it's one of my favorite Pearl Jam songs. And he came out and said, we're not doing it, but When It Mattered Most is a phenomenal title. And I literally stopped in my tracks and was like, that's it. And then I turned to my wife and I was like, Michaela, look at this. And she looked at it, she's like, oh my God, that's it. Right, and it has the dual meaning of the hockey and the war, right? And that was the aspect that we were really looking for, and I'd given up on being able to figure out how to communicate it. And I laughed because you read an excerpt from it, and it was in there also. You know, and all the players that I coach laugh because they say that I say it all the time, and I don't realize that I do. You know, I think it's subconscious, but Yeah, for me it was a perfect title of it had the war element and the sports element to it.
Sorry, I had to sneak that in there.
Important question to ask. If you have additional ones, both Rob and Kevin will be available in the lobby after our program. And if you have yet to buy Kevin's book, we have them for purchase over there, and then they will be available in our museum and memorial store as well. So on behalf of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, this program was proudly presented with the Kansas City Mavericks, who tomorrow and the 25th will be hosting their Military Appreciation Weekend. If you'd like to see more of Kevin, he will be there and to support your local hockey team. So thank you all. Another round of applause for Rob and Kevin.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for spending your time with us tonight. And Kevin, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Appreciate you. This is great.
Yeah.